Welcome to a brand new episode of Sequel Rights, the podcast where we take a look at the franchises that make you go, they made how many of those? And we give each and every sequel a fair trial. My name is Justin Camps, and I'm here with
Elizabeth Helly
and
Tyler Hymanson. I'm from Spain.
Oh,
I can really hear it in your voice.
Can't you tell from my Spanish accent?
I thought you were Egyptian.
Actually. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, that was a little bit further back.
Oh, gosh. You guys, welcome to a brand new episode. We are here talking about a brand new franchise.
That's right.
Highlander kicking off today. Oh, my God. This is going to be fun.
There can only be fun.
I can tell. Oh, man. Well, I hope you guys all enjoyed our series on Bad Boys.
You make it sound like we're like frontline of like our investigative series on Bad Boys.
We did investigate.
Yeah. Yes. Go back and listen to it. If you did like it and want to, you know, shoot us over some love, you can.
Yes, please email us at sequelrights@gmail.com and find us on social media on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at Sequel Rights.
And please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts. 5 stars mean a lot, goes a long way for the algorithm. And I'm going to say it. I think that Bad Boys for Life is the best third movie in any franchise that we've done. Oh. If you disagree, tell us in the comments.
Yeah, fight. Let's fight.
Yeah, what do you think the best third movie is in any franchise?
It's doing really well.
It's
the
doing
box
incredibly
office,
well.
So,
yeah.
Still,
Bring on number 4.
Where it's just like, I don't know why Hollywood can't figure out Will Smith, because like there's obviously star power and with him and Martin Lawrence, but like they just, I don't know. I guess
they just have to do 2 of the same movie, and one of them would be good, and the other one will, you know, just be like the oopsies. Yes.
I think when they're just too over serious, I think that people are just like, eh.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. And like, what is
Well, you didn't like the pursuit of happiness?
What even is a Gemini Man, honestly? Yeah. And not only are we starting off a new franchise here, but we have a special guest interview at the end of the episode. You may remember author Jonathan Melville from our episode on Tremors, the series, but he is back this week to talk about his upcoming book on the making of Highlander. So stay tuned at the end of the episode to hear him talk about that. All right. You guys ready for this? Are you ready for this? I'm going to hit the button, and the trailer's going to play. We can't go back from this.
Okay, well, I hope that Queen is in the trailer.
Ooh.
Oh, well.
From another time comes a man of great power.
Talk funny, Nash. Where are you from?
Lots of different places. A warrior of incredible strength.
You've the devil in you.
We've been kinsmen 20 years.
Connor MacLeod was my kinsman. I don't know who you are.
Because you were born different, men will fear you, try to drive you away.
A man uncertain of his future.
What you got here, Brenda, is a guy who's been creeping around since at least 1700.
Not possible.
And haunted by his past.
Oh, God. I had to let it go until it got to that, what you got here is a guy who's been creeping around for at least since the 1700s. Oh, boy.
Yeah, so this is the movie Highlander.
Yeah.
Which is, I think, interesting in that I think that the central idea of this movie of, like, immortals and the quickening and everything else is much more central to what people think about these movies. As opposed to just the immortal Scotsman that is the Highlander. Like, I think the name is even a misnomer.
Yeah, I was...
Did you see this before?
No, I was just going to say that I was completely unprepared for this movie.
I didn't know anything at all about this movie except that there can only be one. That's all I know, but I didn't know anything about it at all. I was like, wait, we're in the present day or, you know, in the 80s? Like, what's happening?
I knew he was, like, immortal. And there could be only one, and that you can only kill them by cutting their heads off. That's all I knew.
You know that much.
That's all I knew. Wow, you know, in my mind, I was like, okay, there's been a lot of these movies. It's all over pop culture. There's even a TV show. I was like, it must be the first movie. Must be pretty good. And I watched this movie, and you know, it was really funny, actually, for me, you know. I know I've said this on here a lot, but I often fall asleep watching these movies. So I'm trying so hard to pay attention, but trying to fit it in with all sorts of stuff going on. Anyways, I knew we were in for something special where I watched about the first 10 minutes and then fell asleep. And I woke up to the sight of, Chris, what's his name?
Christopher Lambert.
Yeah, Christopher Lambert.
Oh.
And Sean Connery running together along the beach. Oh, like long lost lovers. And I woke up right at this moment and Sean Connery is like,
"This is the quickening!"
And they jump off a cliff out of nowhere. I was like, what the fuck is... What did I miss?
It's quite a frolic, too. It's like carefree, like, you know, lambastic kind of run. It's not like a Tom Cruise situation.
No,
it's like a
no.
frolic for sure.
And he channels the... He has to focus in on the heartbeat of the deer first before he channels the speed of the horse, I guess.
I know this is totally out of order, but I was just... That was how I saw it. I saw the beginning and then that scene.
The reason you keep falling asleep is because you watch the movies in your house. See, the key is when you start getting sleepy, that's when you move from Starbucks to McDonald's or from the train to the train.
Yeah, he has your stops. Yeah. Again, as this movie has a sex scene in it, and so therefore I was watching it in a public place.
Yeah, I was watching it in McDonald's, and then the sex scene starts, and I'm like, oh, God, the play place is right behind me. No!
But I got to go take this over to Burger King, where they appreciate this type of thing.
Thankfully, there was no children, only old people playing Mahjong or something.
There's also a point where the sex scene almost happens, because Christopher Lambert is, like, trying to make moves on his girlfriend on a bunch of rocks, and then Sean Connery just rolls up and
this
he's like,
"This was
hello.
Hilarious." Okay, you're underselling the way he is introduced in this moment. They're like making out on this rock, him and his wife Heather or whatever her name is, they're making out, and she's like, "You can do this to me forever," and he's like, "I will." And they're like, "Da da, kissing," and then all of a sudden it's like, "Yeah!" And the horse jumps over them. You see like the undercarriage of a horse, and it's like, "Yahoy!"
I mean, I'm pretty sure they were like not just making out because her entire
blouse was
off.
Yeah. I think they had finished. Oh, God. But he yeehaws out of nowhere over the top of them, and then he's like, "Ah, my name is super long name from a place. I'm a metallurgic shaman." I don't remember what he said.
Yes, in this movie where Christopher Lambert, who was born in the U.S. but grew up in Switzerland, so he's he has a Swiss accent.
It's one of these inexplicable, like, we ran into this with the Poltergeist Legacy where all the guys had strange European accents that no one could quite place.
So he has this Swiss accent, does not sound Scottish in the slightest.
Or American.
In the slightest. He just sounds like a weirdo. I mean, like, what took you so long?
Honestly, my honest, like, take on this movie was like, this is like The Room level bad movie.
Yeah.
That's how I felt. I was like, the nonsense going on in this movie and the line reading is like so bad. It's like, listen to this.
Are you scared, Connor?
No, Cousin Dougal, I'm not.
No, Cousin Dougal.
We don't have time to explain who you are, friend Tyler. So let's give everyone titles.
Cousin Dougal, no! God. It's just like, I could have, like, I only have so much room on my soundboard here, but I could have loaded up, like, the full movie and been like,
Policeman Richards!
Yeah.
Don't move, pal. Don't even breathe.
That was so ridiculous. Yeah, so before anything, we start with a just ridiculous, nonsensical voiceover that apparently was famously recorded by Sean Connery in the bathroom, and which that's why it's so echoey.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
I mean, that's what all the trivia, Wikipedia, and IMDb, all that stuff says. He recorded it in the bathroom of a Spanish villa because he was there getting voice lessons or dialect lessons from an acting coach to perfect his Spanish accent, which, like, oh my God. Good kudos to that guy who cashed his checks and then ran away all the way to the bank. Like, oh, man. So
was it Donald Trump? Like, was that part of Trump University?
Yeah, I don't know. But apparently when he sent the recording, the producers couldn't tell that it was bad quality or whatever. And so they were like, okay, great, put it in the movie. And that's why it sounds really echoey.
Oh, God. There's so much stuff on this Wikipedia page that I was like, is that real?
Who knows if it's true, but I did see it not just on IMDb, so I was kind of like, okay, that's, yeah.
No, this is one of those that has, and if you're listening, welcome, and we're sorry that we're shitting on this movie.
Well, I know, I'm sorry. No, it's okay.
But this is one of those things where if you look at the IMDb, you can tell that people are fans of this movie because there is a lot of shit up there.
Hey, I'm glad for them.
Yeah.
I won't say that there's nothing here to appreciate. There are some things that we'll get into.
I left with two thoughts from this movie, okay, that relate to other movies that we've talked about. One, Basket Case is a fucking masterpiece of being at like a tenth of this budget and having a bunch of crazy New York shit. And like, it's like this movie had like $12 million, $15 million. Like, Basket Case probably had $2,000. and I just find that incredibly impressive. Second, I think it's one of those things where the idea supersedes the quality of the movie, like The Purge. Like, it's one of those things where, like, there is immortal warriors out there, and they're always stalking each other and trying to find each other. It is something that, and there can only be one, and it's something that I feel like that popular culture has co-opted and coalesced, and it's just part of the DNA.
I wanted to come on here and be like, can someone tell me what a Highlander is?
Yeah, yes.
Because I feel like they don't do a great job of explaining what's
going on. Well, they're
not
all Highlanders.
Yeah, he's the Highlander.
Right, right. Yeah, he is from the Highlands.
Yeah,
but
it's just confusing.
Yeah, I don't know. Did we even learn what they're called?
No.
Just immortals?
They have the blood of kings.
Oh. Okay.
Some people
according to Freddie Mercury.
They're born different.
Yeah.
And
then when you get close to another person who's different, the lightning makes you orgasm.
That's exactly what I was going to say. Like, it makes you and all the inanimate objects around you explode in the biggest orgasm you've ever had in your life.
Hey-oh.
I should have caught one of those recordings. But the first time it happens, he chops off, like, backflip dude's head.
Oh my God, that guy did so many backflips.
Okay, so this movie starts. Okay, so this is a movie. It's directed by, I don't know the guy's name. Russell Mulcahy, big music video director, did a ton of Duran Duran videos, did everything else, and you can tell that who the target audience of this movie is, because it starts at a wrestling match at Madison Square Garden and then ends up with two like cool guys fighting with swords in the parking structure. It's just like, but it starts with tons of wrestling shots. Just like, hey, 13-year-old boys, like, here's a movie for you.
Yeah. And there's, like, some guy yelling.
And proceeds from there.
There's a guy yelling in Christopher Lambert's face, like, yeah, yeah, you gotta love this. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah, there's one shot where, like, everyone in the crowd's going crazy, and then there's just, like, a sad, like, glint.
He's like, why am I here?
Why did he even go? Like, he didn't know that guy next to him.
No.
Like, God.
Maybe he was anticipating. So they
start fighting in the parking lot super slowly. And then there's this old guy who's fighting. But then they just keep cutting away to a small acrobat who just keeps backflipping like Mary Lou Retton.
Yeah, he did like 12 backflips in a row between two rows of cars.
There's a shot where he does like about three, and I was like, okay, weird. And then like they show him doing it again, where it's really a lot longer. And then right after that, it cuts to like a shot of Christopher Lambert looking like, what the fuck? like a super gif-able, like, huh? Like, audience reaction shot, basically.
And as we've seen, it doesn't necessarily, like, if you're immortal or if you're a Highlander, we're just going to call them Highlanders. That's what it is. Even though it's wrong in the context of the movie. It doesn't give you, like, super strength or super powers. Like, he went through his entire life not knowing that he was special. And so this guy was just an old dude who could backflip a lot.
I guess. I thought he was,
and if you're born this way, like, don't you just, like, age to maturity and then you're immortal? Like, everyone else is, I guess, I mean, Connery's old,
yeah,
too.
When do you become
immortal?
It's very unclear.
Did Clancy Brown make him immortal by stabbing him?
Yeah, maybe you become immortal the first time you should have died.
Oh, yeah.
That makes sense. I like that answer.
I do like that
You've
answer.
Thought about this more than the people who made this movie.
I love that whole sequence where we flash back to the past for the first time. And we learn that apparently when you fight wars in early Scotland, you just scream the name of your family house.
That's right. MacLeod! MacLeod!
Krogan! Or whatever it was. Like.
MacLeod! Krogan!
Krogan, yeah.
No, I don't think it's Krogan. No, it's not. That's the master.
But there's this whole scene where he's like... First of all, I was like, if the whole movie is like this, I'm going to be like, what is going on? Because all these crazy shots of like, I don't know if it was a dream of him seeing the guy on the horse on the cliffside, but he's like, no one will fight me, someone fight me. And like the first guy comes up to him and is like, you can fight me. And he's like, okay. And then immediately gets stabbed.
Well, because didn't you say like, save MacLeod for me?
Yeah.
Yeah, he told all the other people they couldn't kill him.
It was just so funny. He was so eager to fight someone, and then he just gets stabbed like he didn't even try.
I gotta say, overall, I found the fighting in this movie to be really bad.
It was very bad. Like
all of it was bad. I'm sorry, stunt people. I'm sure you did the best you could back then with the budget you had, but wow.
I mean,
broadsword fighting is kind of boring.
Yes, that too.
Yeah,
but it was not good.
Some of those training sequences, I mean, it looked like they're just like, let's put them on a cliff, the real actors, and just let them go.
Just like, yeah. Like, I don't know, we put our hands out this way.
Yeah, when they raise their arms, like, yeah!
Yeah.
It looks so lame.
It looks like they're at, like sword fighting for dads at, like, a Westin in Hawaii. Like,
it's so bad. Oh, my God, this movie, you guys.
So, the movie starts in present day. We see Christopher Lambert, and he is,
that's all I think of him as.
He is, an antiques dealer, I guess. And he gets, arrested.
Yeah. Any antiques dealer on Hudson would know that.
Well, they find him, they link him to the scene of the other dude's death.
Right.
Basically the parking structure incident.
Yeah.
And we have the police, like, commissioner guy, Alan North, who was not in the Naked Gun, but he was all over a police squad.
Oh, yes.
And I was like, oh, man, yes.
Yeah.
But he's being serious for the most part in this. But
except for when he's making racist comments and jokes.
Or gay panic.
Yeah, or gay panic.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a lot of good stuff there.
No. 1986, bad.
Yeah, bad for 86.
Yeah, when they said it, I was just like, what? Like, it felt so out of nowhere, even for the 80s. Like,
yeah, and it's
know.
Like, Freddie Mercury is, like, singing on this movie.
Yeah, well, just because it's not relevant at all to what's happening.
Yeah.
You know, like, maybe I would expect to hear that in a video or in a movie where there actually are gay people or something happening, but this is just so out of left field. I don't know.
And then we're getting their flashbacks. The flashbacks are not triggered by anything.
They're just like...
It's kind of like, well, we need to cut away from this scene, so let's
One of my favorite ones is like... Connor MacLeod is just like polishing his sword.
Oh, yes.
In his apartment, and he just all of a sudden is like...
ha, ha, ha.
He's like, wistful thinking. And then, like, the camera pans over to, like, his aquarium, and it goes into the aquarium, and then it's, like, a fish, and then it goes up to the water level, and then it's like, oh, they're on a boat practicing balance.
Which leads to the dumbest sequence in the movie.
Yeah, where he's like...
I don't like boats. I don't like water.
This is the kind of like insane stuff that's happening in the entire movie. I'm just like, why is he singing? It sounds like something that he just
like,
made up.
Do re mi fa so.
And then he just goes balance. It sounds like a fucking Ron Burgundy style like warm up joke.
How now, brown cow?
Exactly.
The Human Torch was denied a bank loan. Balance.
I want to go back though to the original like incident that caused this when it's his first big battle, like you already said. But so his girlfriend is like, bring him back to me. And she like makes out with him and then he goes, he almost dies. She's like weeping over his dead body. And then when he comes back to life, she's like, Satan, you know, like she immediately turns against him.
Devil.
Like, and the guy from Game of Thrones and
Jorah Mormont.
Materials.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's there too. And the girl...
I'll never forget this, Cousin Gregor.
Yeah. The girl, Kate, is actually that actress...
Cousin Dougal.
Celia Imrie, who's like the annoying mom's friend in the Bridget Jones movie. The lady that makes the curry buffet or whatever. Also the... the professor and the I Kiss the Teacher, Mamma Mia 2 song.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And her son is the guy that plays Merlin in The Kid Who Would Be King or whatever. So, but yeah, I totally didn't recognize her. And then I was like, oh, but it's just so funny because she turns like so quickly. Like, she's like, oh, I'm so devastated. I'm in love with this guy. And then just like, devil worship. Yeah, like this is. You know, like evil. And it's like,
she's crying so hard in that part that the guys are like, get out of here. We don't want his last like thoughts to be the sobs of a woman. Yeah. I was like, what the fuck?
And it's like, not only does she like reject him, she's the one leading the charge to like kill him.
They make him a Christ figure and then like crucify him.
It's really messed up. I'm like, wouldn't you think you'd be happy that he somehow is
alive? Yeah, he's fine.
It's not like he suddenly was, like, speaking in tongues and had black eyes or anything.
Well, no, it was because, like, what happened to your Scottish accent?
I never had one.
So he recovers from
I hate boats.
I don't like boats. I'm telling you, man, it's like Tommy Wiseau.
I'm Swiss.
He gets banished. He finds a different wife. They're making their life in some little castle thing and...
Yeah, are we to believe that he built the castle himself?
Oh, I have no idea.
What, that house that he had?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, maybe, because it fell apart so quickly in the
That's true.
Battle, it seems like that there was explosives in the wall. Yeah.
Like if you just pushed on...
That
like,
lightning.
Also, okay, so we get to... Sean Connery shows up and teaches him in the ways of Egyptian Spaniards, I guess.
Yeah, we got to talk about the... We got to continue on with the boat scene.
So
that has one of the best parts of the movie.
So they just dump him in the water, and McCloud is afraid because he cannot swim.
Yeah, and he's like,
get out!
No! Help! 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 Help me, I'm drowning!
You can't drown, you fool! You're immortal!
This is the best part. More random singing. Wait.
I'm alive.
Okay, that's I had to let them play the whole thing because he's like,
you gotta go into like do 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 do.
He's like, I'm alive.
Yeah, he basically is in the Disneyland submarine ride.
It doesn't make any sense though, because as we said before, yes, they're immortal, but they still feel pain. They're not good at things. You know, he almost dies from that mortal wound until he. So, if you were to be immortal and go under the water and breathe it in, I believe that you would asphyxiate fully. And feel all of the pain, and then you would have to be, revived, and you would come to life or whatever, right?
This scene,
I would say that that Marvel Comics has addressed this in that Wolverine, who is basically immortal because he heals so fast, his biggest fear is water.
Yeah,
because he would still drown.
Yeah. This is so. This whole scene, I could not handle watching this, you guys, because it's like. So goofy looking.
Like, when Geppetto is like, Pinocchio! He's like the bubble sound.
He's like touching his face, and then he goes, ha, 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 ha. And he like laughs underwater. And he's like looking around like, I'm underwater. And then he pulls out his sword, and he's like, I'm gonna cut you. I don't know, he says something like that.
He like attacks the kelp.
Yeah.
And then he like
it
makes,
looks so goofy.
It looks like that he is, it's a rehearsal for the original Creature from the Black Lagoon, and he is like he doesn't have the suit on yet, and he's down there like blah, 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 blah.
Oh my god, it's so
good. And not
so
and not a high fantasy action movie from 1986.
It's so goofy.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, man. So I guess he finds out from Sean Connery that there can only be one, and you can kill them by beheading each other.
And they all hang out at Burning Man.
Yeah.
The gathering. The Gathering.
Really saw a gathering, though.
They all play Magic the Gathering.
None of it makes sense.
And they have a few other guys pop up to show that, like, yeah, you can be friends because they're the only people who understand you, but you also know that you kind of eventually have to kill each other.
Yeah, and there's some vague, like, thing about, like, oh, whoever is last gets a prize of some sort.
Yeah, the prize.
The prize.
Yeah.
The knowledge of all mankind.
They get to hear the song, Gimme the Prize by Queen. From
and, like, I mean, did they say this in the movie, or did I just read it, that you get the power to enslave all of humanity?
No, they
did. They say it in the movie.
Oh, they do.
Oh, okay. I thought he says that he can hear everyone's thoughts or something.
Well, that's
no,
after.
No, they said that Clancy Brown would use it to enslave all humanity.
Okay. So, yeah.
That, I guess that makes sense.
Yeah.
He would do that.
Speaking of Clancy Brown.
Clancy Brown in this movie is a total hunk. No, I mean, it's the youngest I've ever seen him in a movie, I feel like. And he's basically, like,
drowning in the river of ham, chewing on all the scenery.
Yeah.
Running over all the pedestrians.
He thinks that he is in a Mad Max movie.
Mm-hmm. He might be.
Yeah.
He's in the Beyond Thunderdome.
Yeah, just be Toe Cutter and go for it. It's weird. There's a point in this movie where, like, we've seen him as, like, he looks like he's from Army of Darkness when he's fighting in the flashbacks. He looks like a demon.
He's got
lord.
bone armor. Yeah.
And then we see him. He's like a punk in New York in the 80s. Yeah. And he's introduced as, like, he's putting his sword together, whatever it is. And then some hooker comes in and she's like, my name's Candy. And he's like, of course you are.
That was so weird. Okay, wait. Can we talk about
and it's like, what?
Can we talk about his Build-A-Sword? Like, would that be good?
No.
I was like, okay, cool, you can put it in a briefcase, but, like, isn't it going to just, like, break apart?
It's like the difference between the lightsaber you buy at Galaxy's Edge and the one you buy in Tomorrowland that can, like, retract into itself. Yeah.
How strong are those connectors that you're putting together there? I don't know, I didn't...
Of course you are.
That was... this.
So he's, he's our main antagonist. He really wants to kill...
all the high quickeners.
He's a psychopath.
Yeah.
All the quickeners.
I mean, his look was kind of cool he got the, like...
Nesquik. Sorry.
When he got the safety pin, like, neck thing. Yeah. That was pretty cool, but, yeah, I don't know. He's out of
Did
control.
He always have it? He must have always...
I think he did, or if he did, it didn't have safety pins.
No, because the cut was supposed to be from...
Sean Connery.
Yeah,
I guess so. We should admit him and Sean Connery have, like, basically what I'm pretty sure... the Game of Thrones people directly copied for the Clegane Bowl. It looked exactly like that. Yeah. They're on the stairs and the walls are falling. Anyways, but Sean Connery kind of lamely loses to him. It didn't even, like, really look like it was like he tried that hard. But for some reason, he thinks it'll be better to tell Kurgan that Heather is his wife, and not,
right.
Why did he think that would be a better idea?
Back in the flashback, to clarify where we are, back in the flashback, like, it's after the training has happened, and, like, we've seen, like, Connor's training is complete.
And I don't even know where Connor was. Why wasn't he there?
It's like now it cuts to, like, a random night at the castle, and Sean Connery's telling a story about how he jumped in some girl's window, and she wasn't there, so he just hit on whatever girl was there. And she's delighted by this story. And then Krugan shows up out of nowhere, and he's like, where's the guy that I killed? Like, I want to kill him and not you, because I know you.
Yeah.
But I'll fight you. I don't know, whatever. And then so they fight, and it's not clear where Connor is. He's, like, at, like, night church or something.
He's at Vespers or something? What the hell?
And so to go even further on this, so they fight, the whole house explodes somehow. Like, there's, like, the walls are being, like, and, like, they go upstairs and downstairs. Apparently I don't know shit about sword fighting, because Sean Connery has the high ground for most of this, and it doesn't mean
what
anything.
The hell?
He's just too old, I think. Even though he's immortal.
I have the high ground.
He should have looked at a deer first or something.
Oh, by the way, the actress that plays Rachel is Ewan McGregor's aunt-in-law.
Oh.
Oh, Rachel? Oh, okay. Speaking we haven't even talked about ground. Her yet.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, he's killed. Connor never shows up. And then we find out, like, it's revealed later in the movie that Krugan raped his wife.
Well, yeah, I thought that was sort of weird because like, he basically kills Sean Connery, and then she's, like, hiding, or she's, like, coming up, and he's, like, not to... He says, like, gotcha, or something.
To be fair, the first thing that Sean Connery says is, get out of here. Yeah. And she stays there the entire time.
And screams like an idiot. Stupid. But anyways, yeah, I was kind of like, well, he's either going to rape her or kill her, right? But then later you see this whole, like,
she gets old, yeah,
of them growing old together.
Montage is hilarious.
Yeah,
it's the same actress with bad makeup.
Because there's this whole... Okay, wait. Because there's this whole thing about how, like, Sean Connery's like, oh, yeah, I've lived so many lives. Like, you got to just let this girl go because you can't have any kids.
Yeah.
And also, like, you're going to watch her die because you're immortal. And he's like, Connor McLeod's like, yeah, I should probably do that, yeah. And then he, you know, Sean Connery dies. He's like, oh, sweet, now that this guy's dead, we can have this montage of her growing old. But it was the way they show it is so funny. He, like, comes home and he's like walking around outside the house like, Heather, and he comes up over the hill and she's like off in the distance,
yeah,
and she's like, here I am, and she's so far away that she kind of looks the same.
Yeah,
because through this whole montage, you know, she kind of looked the same,
right?
She's walking closer and she still kind of looks the same, but as soon as she gets close, it's like a really close-up shot of her, and it's just, yeah, really bad old person makeup. Yeah.
Like high school theater old.
And I was like,
makeup.
Oh, fuck. She got old. Okay. Yeah.
That said, I did think that this actress sold the relationship better than the two other girlfriends in this movie.
For sure.
Heather.
And she's on Poldark now, and I did not even recognize her. Like, I knew, I was like, this lady is so familiar to me. And then I looked it up, and she plays like the, like, heavy set, spent, like, always drunk maid of Poldark. And so it was kind of funny. But yeah, even though the makeup was lacking, I thought she kind of did a good job.
No, it's just like, no, it's just insane. Like, to answer the question, like, where the fuck was Connor?
Yeah, who knows?
Like, because, like, she killed his master, raped his wife, and then, did he come back for, like, was he gone for weeks? Like, what happened?
No explanation.
He's like, oh, like, oh, our house is gone.
Well, and I mean, I guess it's like,
and like the house is built in the flashback. Did he rebuild it?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't know if it's to her credit or just sad that she didn't tell him what happened. Like, I mean,
right.
What can he really do? You know, at that point. But like, it is very sad when the reveal is given that. Kurgan's like basically implies and he realizes what happened or whatever, and like he's real gross about it too, and I didn't like that scene. I don't know. And it was in a church.
Yeah. because part of the random rules of this is that they can't attack each other on sacred ground.
Sanctuary.
Sure.
Yeah.
Of what church?
Right.
P.S. Yeah. Like, you know, they're immortal. Why do they even give a crap about like a
right.
Yeah, an earthly, you know, church organization.
Presbyterians, anyway. Probably. Only on the ground of the non-denominational church.
Turns out...
you know, the one with the praise band. Sorry, what were you going to say?
Oh, I don't even know anymore. I was going to say something. Oh, apparently this movie was like edited when it originally was in the United States, but I think I must have watched like the director's cut or whatever on Amazon.
Yeah, this is something that we will encounter, I think, with almost every single one of these.
Okay.
Where like there was a theatrical cut, and that version is like almost never been the version that's released on video. So this one is like the director's cut version that adds back in like that weird British flashback scene. And like the scene.
That is the best part of the movie.
Apparently the scene where he meets Rachel was not in the theatrical
cut. Yeah, which is
cut. Weird.
Yeah. And then also apparently Kurgan like randomly licking the priest or the minister, which is super gross, but like, yeah.
And there was a weird shot too, like when McLeod first gets like stabbed and he's dying on the battlefield. That like, was clearly from like a different source.
Right.
Where all of a sudden it was like super blurry. I was like, oh, what?
There is a cut in this movie, I believe, when he becomes quickened, where it just cuts to a mannequin. There's a mannequin's head.
Yes. Yeah. Like an action figure or something. Yeah.
What is the quickening? Can you explain? Like, because that one scene, they make
it's an album by the Vandals.
The scene on the beach, they make it seem like He's going quicker.
I think it's like they get more and more powerful so that they all get the urge to kill each other.
The way that I've always interpreted this, and this has taken nothing from the movie, is that there is a descendant of immortal bloodlines, right?
Yep.
And that's out there in the world. And it's always out there and it's propagating whatever it is. And if you kill a source of that bloodline, then you gain its power. Hmm. And so that there is some people that are like, you know, we can be immortals. We can do a lot of good. And they're not trying to hunt each other down, but they always have to be on the defense because someone's always going to be trying to come and get their power.
Yeah, I mean, they do seem like they're like Dragon Ball Z powering up every time they kill somebody.
Yeah, but nobody can have kids.
Well,
That's true.
Not until the end of the movie where he's like, no, you can.
Oh, yeah, but then he's not immortal anymore, right?
No, I think he is.
Oh, he's still immortal?
Yeah.
I think so.
Ah, shit.
He's just the strongest one.
No. And then, he just said he was just like, oh, you weren't ready yet. And it's like, what? Fuck you.
huh? This doesn't make any sense.
Sean Connery, what year was Dragonheart compared to this?
So let's see. This was 1986.
Oh, Dragon
probably
Heart
almost
after.
10 years. Almost 10 years.
Yeah, Dragonheart was 96. Because yeah, 96.
Sean Connery's just cashing those damn checks, being like, "Yeah, I'm here. I'm wise, and I trained you. Bye." You know.
This is before he did fucking Last Crusade.
Yeah, I actually looked when they went to that flashback in Scotland. I looked to see if it was the same. I was like, "Oh, is that the same castle?"
Yeah, it looks really similar.
Yeah. But it is not.
There's probably one of those or a dime a dozen over there.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. That would have been really funny if it was the same.
Well, we haven't said anything about his romantic interest for this movie, which is something that one thing that I will say that they did well with this.
Really?
Yeah, what? One thing.
Oh, I thought it comes out of nowhere.
No, it does. She's a police forensic scientist, and she's also a big nerd.
Mm-hmm. She's an expert in metallurgy. Yeah.
In ancient swords.
This metal was folded over 20 times.
Yeah, they didn't start doing that until this other year.
It'd be like, I did appreciate the analogy. It'd be like, that'd be like finding evidence of a Boeing 737 before the Wright brothers even took flight.
Yeah.
I don't even remember that.
Yeah.
I like shows up with her book wrapped up and she's like, "What? How'd you find this?"
Because she's trying to do a sting operation where she's lying to him. It doesn't make any sense.
That scene when he's going around her apartment like, "Wow, great view. Lovely music you got here." And he sees the recorder.
She's got the plot scary. Of every female professional that isn't respected by her male colleagues. I'm like, I'm going to go off the books and conduct this investigation on my own.
I do love the moment when she pulls a fast one on the commissioner where she's like, "Oh, I left my purse. I have to go get back in the room and get my purse." And she uses him to be like, he obviously is like, "Oh, sure. Girl stuff? Okay." Yeah. And she goes through here.
Sorry, I need a tampon. I'm bleeding out my vagina right now.
Yeah. I like that moment that she totally tricked him.
Yeah, it was right after the cop said he didn't want to deal with a case about a guy whose Vietnamese neighbor ate his dog.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Terrible.
Oh, yeah. Also, where this Japanese sword came from is because the Egyptian, Spanish, Scottish Sean Connery was in love with a Japanese princess at some point.
Shocker.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll get to see that story.
Hopefully. It's called The Last Samurai. You can rent it.
Tom Cruise
is
The Last Jedi.
Yeah, so he falls in love real quick, apparently, with
Because his interests are swords, I guess. And so he's in love with her.
He's like, "Let me show you this special sword I've got in my pants.
It's immortal.
Hey, you kind of look like my past two girlfriends."
Yeah.
It's over 1,700 years
it's old. It's been lurking around for over 1,700 years.
Okay, you were watching this on the train, right?
I was.
So this is another moment in the movie where I was watching it by myself this morning and laughed out loud because of the insanity. There's lots of crazy transition moments in this movie.
Yes.
But this one in particular I thought was great. There's this really emotional love scene going on with lots of butts. butts popping off.
Lots of silhouetted nipples.
Yeah.
There's a chance that I missed this transition because I might have done the skip forward 10 seconds.
And smart. So, like, they're in the middle of this, like, really passionate love scene, and there's this music, and here's what happens, like, right here. Oh, they love each other. They're kissing.
Butts.
So many butts. Lions! Lions! There's lions, and they're at the zoo all of a sudden.
I was...
It's like the scene does not end. It's just all of a sudden, like, smash cut to lions.
I was very confused. I was just like, skip ahead 10 seconds, skip ahead 10 seconds. And then I was like, did I skip too far? It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it's one of those moments where we're like, wait, whoa. Did my internet just cut out for a second? Like, how did they, what? Now they're at the zoo?
It's a metaphor, Justin.
But the lions weren't having sex.
I know it's like a lion roaring, but it sounds like a comedic timpani or something.
No, it sounds like a boer whirl.
Yeah.
It sounds like they were like, well, we didn't film an end of this scene, so let's just interrupt it with loud noises.
Oh, God.
Lions.
The end of the scene is you fall asleep. I know. How hard is that? Like, oh, my God. Like,
no, that would require him to show affection.
I love that.
And then what's, like, yeah, they're at the zoo, and they're saying, like, this can't be a thing?
They have some plan. Yeah, I don't remember.
Thankfully, she is pretty... modern independent woman, and she's just kind of like, all right, well, you know, don't get yourself killed, see ya, thanks for the memories. Like, okay, but obviously she gets dragged back into it, but yeah
because Gold Krugeron kidnaps her.
Yeah, and we get there's another immortal guy involved briefly.
Oh, right. And then there's like a marine. Prepper
yeah
guy.
There's like one black immortal guy just to like prove that there is one,
right?
Yeah. Yeah,
he's cool.
Yeah,
I want to spend like I'd watch his movie.
Sure.
Yeah. That scene was weird with the guy with the gun.
Yes,
that was strange.
No, he's like a Vietnam vet.
Hey, what's going on over here?
So the Highlander of color. Mm-hmm. That is Captain Panaka from Episode One.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
yeah. There's actually a lot of Star Wars people in this movie.
Yeah,
like a bunch of like the Tusken Raiders and like a bunch of like weird like.
Sure.
His name was in the movie is Sunda Kastagir.
Yeah, he has a cool like scimitar.
Yeah,
like sword. Like mm-hmm. it's like I'm way more interested in whatever this guy's story is.
Mm-hmm. But he unfortunately gets killed.
Yeah, like
well,
kind
yeah,
of like
can only be one.
Yeah,
kind of like, but like why? Like why? Like why?
Yeah.
There can be only one.
There can be
we also,
only fun.
We talked briefly about Rachel, but Rachel is his long-suffering secretary, assistant, daughter, slash maybe girlfriend, slash mother-like figure. I don't know.
He protected her during World War II, which gives the... Do you have a clip of this?
I do
like it when he shoots the Nazi. That was
yeah,
hilarious.
There's a point where he shoots the Nazi. He's like, whatever you say, Jack, you're the master race. But he says it in a German accent.
Yeah. Was it? I thought
he's Swiss.
He was saying it in an American accent.
Yes.
I did not. The accents are just everywhere. But anyways, he saves her. She's like a little kid. The little kid version of... Rachel is Nicola Ramsey, Child Star Chicken. She is now the publisher and head of editorial of Islamic and Middle Eastern Studies at Edinburgh University Press.
Hmm. Nice.
So she really got into the antiquities, I guess, or something. I don't know.
We want to get to the big final confrontation.
He is immortal.
Yeah, we got to say, too, yeah, okay.
Infused with the blood of kings.
This is what I was like, how in the world is Queen involved in this movie?
So, my girlfriend was singing the song. She can sing the song from, like, heart. She's like, I want to say it's Queen, and I was like, there is no way that it's Queen.
It's all Queen.
And I was incredibly wrong.
Boy, are you wrong. I mean, if you have to have a ridiculous soundtrack, why not have it be Queen? It's pretty good.
This is my favorite. So I was like on the Wikipedia trying to figure out, like, how the fuck did Queen get involved in this? And my favorite news tidbit, which I don't know if it's real or what, but it's hilarious to think of. It says, Brian May was inspired to write Who Wants to Live Forever after watching the love scenes between Connor and his wife, Heather, which the song ultimately accompanied in the film.
Hey.
So you're saying he was like, yeah. These love scenes are really getting me going. I'm gonna write a bad song about it.
How dare you?
What, you like the song?
No, I don't like them. Yeah. It kind of reminds me of all, like, if they make this now, they can just, like, make it with Fall Out Boy and just put in those songs from Big Hero 6.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The Princes of the Universe song is kind of fun. You know, it's like a cheesy Flash Gordon type song.
Yeah.
We're the princes of the universe. I was just like, I mean, you know, I thought, oh, it's just this one song, but no, it's like throughout the entire movie.
Yeah, yes.
Whew.
It's because the director did a bunch of Queen music videos.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. But, yeah, so we get to this big final confrontation.
Which originally was supposed to be on the Statue of Liberty.
Oh.
Then it was supposed to be in the Empire State Building. Mm. Then it was supposed to be an amusement park. And then they just settled for some sign.
Yeah, what does the sign even say?
Silver Cup.
Oh, that's right.
And, like, the warehouse from Flashdance or something.
Right.
Like,
were they like, you know, yeah, Ghostbusters came out in 84.
Yeah.
Were they like, well, we can't do the Statue of Liberty
anymore. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. It's kind of just like a...
They fight. It's kind of boring. Fight, yeah. And it looks like he's losing. He loses his sword, but then he has...
There's that hilarious moment where, like... Clancy Brown is, like, standing on the ground and, like, spinning, like, yeah, and, like, cutting all of the, like, yeah, all of the base of the sign, but he's doing, like, a little ballerina twirl as he does it every time. Weird. Weird stuff.
Yeah.
By the way, when he wanted to prove to, what's-her-face, not Rachel, Brenda, that he was immortal, instead of, like, forcing her to stab him, even though I said the water thing was not consistent, wouldn't you do that rather than force her to, like, traumatically stab you?
Especially if it seems like the wounds carry over. But, like, did he force her to do it or did she just do it?
No. He, like, grabbed her arm and, like, stabbed himself with it.
Okay.
Ugh.
Look, I'm immortal. Oops, look, I forgot look at I can me. Still
I can
feel
eat all,
pain.
I can eat all the egg salad I want. Cholesterol isn't shit to me.
That would have been better.
Yeah.
Mm. It all leads to him finally defeating Krugan, and
with some of Rachel's help, she hits him with the pipe, and he's like, "What took you so long?
What took you? Where were you?
Where were you? What took you so long?"
Yeah, he does say some. I don't understand his character because he is like joking around the entire movie. I'm like, is he supposed to be like a doofus or what? I don't know. But it leads to this, like, really crazy ending sequence where, like, he is the only one. Yeah. And then suddenly out of nowhere, there's this insane, like, animated sequence.
There's, like, demons, and they're, like, barfing skulls into him.
Yeah, it's like, it's almost like a Night on Bald Mountain, like, ghosts flying around him, you know? Yeah. I was just like, where is this coming from all of a sudden? And he's, like, floating up in,
also,
like, a cyclone.
And it makes it seem like... This power is bad. Like, maybe his wife was right.
Yeah, it looks like a lot of evil shit is going on, pretty much. I don't know. But I was just like, whoa, this is out of nowhere, because all the effects in the rest of the movie have been pretty bad.
But it turns out that even if you take on all the world's evil, if you just put on a nice white sweater vest and have a little picnic on the Irish seaside, you're fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's revealed that the prize is actually that you can just hear everyone's thoughts,
right?
Control their mind that way.
Which I don't think this was
the prequel to Have What Women Want.
So yeah, basically, you find out that, like, the power, you know, if it had been in Kurgan's hands, yeah, he would have used it to enslave humanity. But in this guy's hands, he's just kind of like, okay, cool. I'm just gonna live my own life. He says he has the ability to, like, garner world peace and, like, you know, scientific discovery, but it doesn't seem like he's planning to actually do anything with that. He just wants to have sex with Brenda.
Right.
Yeah, until she gets old and dies, and he'll just find another one.
But then he does have Force Ghost buddy Sean Connery being like, whoa, like, hey, Connor, like, good work. I couldn't tell you everything. but there's more to learn. I'm Spanish.
I mean, yeah, and it's unclear.
Juan Sanchez Villalobos Ramirez.
I mean, they like what they say.
I would like to meet and give a medal to the dialect coach.
You tried your best. You tried your best, sir. I'm sorry.
Your best.
No, he's winner's probably
get out of my way, you Spanish peacock.
He's probably just a random Spanish guy, like the Cinderella story mom that just picked up a random Indian guy and made her a guru. They probably just saw, oh, you speak Spanish? You're from Spain? Like, you're a dialect coach, right? And he was like, sí. You know?
I love thinking, he's going to just, like, walk off into the sunset and, be with Brenda till she gets old, and then, you know, he'll have a repeat of that earlier scene when he's telling Rachel, like, it's time for Russell Nash to die.
Also, like, Russell it's not Nash clear. Dies today. Is that just it? Like, I mean, it was four centuries that we saw him specifically, but, like, are more going to be born, and then there's going to be another quickening and another whatever?
Maybe.
I think we're going to find out.
I love that I love the explanation. They go through that whole explanation about how, like, he's taken the names of babies who died when they were really young. Like, Jesus. Like, this guy's been planning this out his whole life. But that's basically the end of the movie.
Yeah.
It goes out on another Queen track.
How many boat songs would you give?
Balance.
B-A-L-A-N-C.
I mean, I think we've just got to hear it again.
B-A-L-A-N-C.
Balance. I don't like boats. I don't like water.
I don't like boats. I don't like water.
I
don't like boats. I'm Scottish.
Get me away from boats.
It's just so.
I am Scottish.
You have Sean Connery, who is Scottish, playing a Spanish guy and trying to give him a Spain or Catalan accent. And then you have this guy from Switzerland that you're forcing to act Scottish, but also American.
So many.
A Scottish guy in disguise as an American who's really Swiss. Like, why? You know? Like, God, this is why we should have, authentic casting.
Why?
Balance.
So wait, how many boat songs?
How many boat songs? Or, I mean, we could say botched accents.
How many botched accents?
Yeah.
You know what? I'm going to go and I'm going to give this 3.
That is.
No, I'm going to give it 1, 2, 3.
You got to do it like a funny accent.
Botched accents.
That's actually less than appear in the movie.
That's true. Like I said, I don't know. I kind of I had a lot of fun watching this movie because I thought it was dumb. And I came away being like, wait, are there people that like this movie, like, unironically? Like,
there has to be.
I mean, I guess there are.
Yeah.
But to me, I was like, how can you not watch this? And I guess maybe people love it because it's so bad.
Maybe.
I just thought it was really bad. And honestly, like I said, like a Room style level of bad.
Yeah.
Where the line reading is just like, huh? Why'd he say that? Why'd he say, like, of course you are? You know, like stuff like that. Why?
Why is
Sean Connery singing at this moment?
Balance.
I guess, you know, it came out at a time, I don't think it did very well, actually.
No, it didn't.
Yeah.
But I think it kind of garnered a cult following just because of the insanity of it.
Yeah.
And like you said, the story behind it. And then it was by, the Canon Film Group that did Missing in Action or whatever. And you know that they're just going to make another one.
Yep.
So there's more. I'm going to give it 3 bulged excellence. I'm sorry, that was a botched accent.
I'm going to give it 2 botched accents because, I mean, it's real bad, like you said. But Tyler said it right at the top, like, somehow the nugget of the idea is like, oh, that's a cool idea.
Yeah.
But it's just such bad execution. But you're kind of like, you know, the fact that we even want to ask those questions about, okay, like, well, right. what happens next? Is he immortal? Can he have kids? We, you know, like, that just shows that it's, like, a really interesting idea.
Yeah.
And I thought for sure, like, oh, this has got to be based on, like, a book series or something. And it was just some screenwriting student from UCLA that yep. came up with a random idea as his class project and then sold it for, like, you know, however much. And Lucky. It just went from there. So it just... something about like that idea was really fascinating to people and made it into a however more many movies we're going to watch series. But this one
and like five seasons of television.
And this whole thing, like, I feel like could have been so improved, honestly, just by better fighting. Better
yes. fight choreography. Oh, no, like that's the thing that you thought that it was going to be. It's like I thought that there would be action.
Yeah,
like,
cool
the,
action.
Like the action beats would be fun at least, or there'd be something cool.
Yeah, well, that's one thing that you can say about Chuck Norris and, yeah. you know, whatever, and Rambo or whoever, you know, like at least the fighting, you're like, right. okay, yeah. you know, like I'm here for this, but this is just kind of real bad.
I am going to give it two botched accents. I think that this movie is barely a movie.
Yeah.
And I think that Christopher Lambert is Tommy Wiseau very much.
Yeah.
And although I'm going to bump it up one more point just for the fucking balls to be like, Sean Connery is Spanish and you're going to fucking deal with it. We're going to dress him up like he's Spanish. He's going to run around and say things like he's Spanish and fuck you.
Also, act like you're in love with each other for this entire montage. Maybe you'll kiss at the end.
Oh, also montage. Like four female characters. No Bechdel test. Fail.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
They're all like, help me, Connor. Save me, Connor.
Is that including Candy or no?
Okay, fine.
Predictions for, would we have a, what's the title of the next movie?
The next one's called Highlander 2, The Quickening. And, yeah.
I feel like it gets over, I hope that it feels like it moves by quicker.
the very tiny amount I've seen about this movie, I think we are in for quite the treat.
I'm going to guess that it doesn't even go forward and that it's like more stuff that we didn't see from this initial quickening that already happened.
Yeah.
Well, that's my guess.
It's just like more flashbacks.
Yeah.
That would, yeah, I mean.
It's like, here's a different scene with her at the castle.
Yeah.
Heather, they're going to be making, out on a different rock.
Yeah, this time.
And Sean Connery's going to be telling a different filthy story.
I mean, yeah, because the movie kind of ended, like, you know, at the end.
Yeah, he had a white sweater on. They had some wine. They were having a picnic.
Maybe he'll have a kid in this one.
Oh, maybe.
It's kind of interesting, too, to think about that we're kind of, like, about to deal with the same sort of thing with Wonder Woman of, like, oh, she's immortal. She's popping up in different time periods of history. Like, now she's in 84, so it'll be interesting to see how that works.
And which characters were killed come back in this one.
Yeah, Sean Connery, hopefully.
Oh, God. Well, man, that's going to be next week. I can't wait, actually. Because if this first movie is any indication, it's gonna get crazy.
Yes.
We're only on movie one of five. Oh boy. What have we done? What have we done? But hey, we slagged off this movie a lot today. But hey, maybe you love this movie. Maybe you want to tell us why we're so wrong.
I would honestly love to know why. Yes. Like, please tell us.
Please. Write in and tell us.
I think it's one of those things where, like, looking back, I mean, we're almost 30 years removed from this movie at this point. Like, getting close to that. And it's like, you know, watching it when you're seven, like, I imagine it could be completely different.
Guys saw it when you were, like, adolescents, you would love it, like, the way that you guys like the first two Bad Boys. And I was like, what the hell?
Yeah. You're right. No, I think absolutely. And I think that the thing that I would like to hear from everybody, either put it in a 5-star review for us or tweet at us, we're not going to be able to cover all of the Highlander TV show episodes in this. I know that there's going to be a lot of viewers out there who watch the show. If there's a particular crazy episode or something that you remember from the TV show, let us know. We'll try to find that episode. Maybe that's one of them we'll include in our little review if we're talking about. Actually, I don't even know if we're talking about a TV show.
There's three different shows.
Okay, fair enough.
I don't know. Yeah, we'll see.
We'll figure it out at some point.
We want to do Highlander the rest of the year.
Yeah.
Depends how many downloads we get.
P-A-N-C-E. Violence.
Anyways, yeah, email us. Sequel Rights.
Yeah, anyways.
Sequel Rights at gmail.com, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at Sequel Rights.
All right. It's time now for our interview with author Jonathan Melville about his upcoming book on the making of Highlander. Hope you enjoy.
I'm happy to be talking with Jonathan Melville, the author of the unofficial Tremors Guide, and we talked to him before when we were doing that series, and coincidentally, he's also working on a book about Highlander, so we're excited to hear his thoughts on that. Thank you so much, Jonathan, for talking to us.
Oh, not a problem. Thanks for getting in touch. Good to chat to you again.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I know that you're still working on the Highlander book. Are you focusing specifically on this first movie?
Yeah, just the first one mainly. Yeah, I've got, so far I've written about, I don't know, maybe 15 chapters, I think, on that first film, and gone into quite a lot of detail. So I just think to try and then cover all the other ones in as much detail would just not happen, and wouldn't you know, just, I don't have the time really. But also, you know, the first one is my favorite one, so I don't want to be writing about something I don't really enjoy. It needs to be something that you have a real passion for. And I think the first film is one that I can just watch again and again, whereas the sequels, not so much.
Okay. So we actually haven't watched any of the sequels yet. So okay. You can talk about it, but don't spoil it for me.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. So what made you, like, so how did you first become familiar with this series, and what made you want to write about it?
Well, I think, although I live in Scotland, I live in Edinburgh, in Scotland, the capital of Scotland. When the film came out, when Highlander came out, I was 10. Mm-hmm. And I was living in the Highlands of Scotland, bizarrely, quite sort of north of Inverness in Scotland. So it's quite far north. But we didn't have a cinema near us in this little village that I lived in. And so at the age of 10... You know, I wasn't particularly up in my, and this was in 1986. So at this point, of course, we didn't have the internet, and we didn't have too many ways of finding out about films that were maybe kind of culty, because Highlander was never exactly, you know, a mainstream film. Of course, it's a science fiction / fantasy romantic time travel type film. So, sure. So anyway, I wasn't that aware of it when it came out. And I didn't see it, although we had a local video store. I don't ever remember seeing it in there, and I don't remember any friends talking about it. So it was just kind of, it came out, and maybe I heard about it vaguely at some point, but didn't know too much. So when I really got to know it was a few years later. It would have been maybe, I think, about 1994, so a few years later, when I came to university in Edinburgh. And there was a double bill, a midnight double bill of Highlander and The Crow, which I went along to. And that's where I discovered two fantastic films, but in particular Highlander, which I just remember really loving and just thinking, I wish I'd heard about this sooner. I wish I'd discovered it sooner. I wish I'd bought the video. So I was kind of a late comer to Highlander. Bizarrely, even though I live in Scotland and I did live in the Highlands. So.
Oh, wow. So, yeah, like, people in Scotland do know about this movie, or they don't? Like, what do you think the consensus is?
They do. Maybe I was in the minority. I'm not sure. But certainly it's a very well, I think it's a pretty well-known film here. A lot of people, I'm sure you talked about in your chat about the accent.
I don't yes. know.
Yeah, so everyone says it when they talk about Highlander. Of course, you've got a Scotsman playing a Spaniard, and you've got French-American actor playing a Scotsman. So this bizarre thing going on with accents. And I think that has become, that is a bit like Mel Gibson's accent in Braveheart. It's just kind of a common thing. I think before people talk about the film, they talk about the accents. So I think that's kind of one way they've become or it's become a famous film, well known here. But no, people do know it, and I think people are like it. We have an affectionate, you know, connection to it, where people enjoy the fact that it's crazy and just this mad fantasy film that took place and was filmed in our country.
Sure.
And because Scotland is quite a small country, we don't really have a film industry as such. We've never really had, we don't have a film studio. We've got BBC Scotland, which is based here, and STV, which is Scottish Television, and they're based in Glasgow. And we have a few other offices of the BBC around, but Scotland doesn't have really a film industry. So I think anything that is filmed here and set here, we kind of take to our hearts a little bit more than others, because it's although it's not Scottish, it kind of is Scottish, and we can kind of claim it as our own. So, yeah. So I think people generally are quite, as I say, have a sort of fondness for this film, even if we realise that it's just completely crazy and, you know, okay, just a mad film.
Yeah. So what made you want to do the book on it, and how's it been going so far? Like, what have you found out?
What made me want to do it? Well, I suppose when I wrote the Tremors book, I was looking around. That happened for various reasons, partly because I was looking to write a book. I wanted to try writing a book,
mm-hmm.
partly because I love Tremors and its sequels, and I wanted to know more about those films, and nobody else has written a book on them. So I thought, well, that's perfect. I'll write that book myself. And with Highlander, it's a similar sort of situation in that I was sort of thinking about writing another book, but the Tremors book came out in 2015. And I was trying to take a break from it and thinking, you know, I'm kind of tired after a few years of late nights and early mornings and weekends spent writing this book. Maybe I could take some time off. So that came out in 2015. And then in 2016, I was having this idea of maybe trying something on Highlander. And at the same time, roughly the same time, it was announced that we have an Edinburgh International Film Festival, which has been running for something like 80 years, I think, or 75 years or something like that. So it's been going on for a long time. And they announced in sort of the spring, early summer, that they were going to be inviting Clancy Brown to the festival for a 30th anniversary screening of Highlander. And so at that point, I think I'd actually emailed his agent not long before that, and I hadn't heard anything. And the same with Christopher Lambert and Sean Connery. And so when I heard that Clancy was coming to town, I thought, well, Clancy doesn't do many interviews on Highlander. He kind of distanced himself from the franchise many years ago. So I thought if I could get an interview with him, then that would be almost worth starting this project properly. And I got the interview. So I spoke to him a couple of times. I spoke to him in the sort of queue, in the sort of video, what am I trying to say, the sort of press section outside the cinema when they were about to show Highlander. So I spoke to him there, and then managed to get 20 minutes with him later on. So I had this nice little interview with him, being quite honest about his time on this film and why he didn't want to come back and do others. And it kind of just snowballed from there, really. So that was, what, 2016. And now we're in 2020, and I must have about 55, 56 interviews, something like that. Wow. And that's just on the one film.
Okay.
With the Tremors book, I covered four films and a TV series, and I interviewed about 55 people. So I think I've, and I keep meaning to stop, and I keep thinking, okay, I've got the interviews now, that's fine. And then something will happen, and I'll see another name, or someone appears on Twitter, you know, one of the cast or crew, and I end up sort of maybe thinking, oh, maybe I could just interview them, or I could reach out to them, and then they say yes, and then it's like, okay, there's another interview. So I'm trying to stop, although I did do another interview the other week by accident sort of thing, and another one might happen soon. So yeah, sort of finished with interviews, but
okay. Well, what are some of the big people that you've gotten to interview as far as, are they actors or mostly craftspeople?
Well, I would say most of the people are behind the scenes, but mm-hmm. I have spoken to, as well as Clancy, I spoke to Christopher Lambert. Spoke to him for about an hour and a half on the phone. He phoned me up. We managed to swap numbers to his agent or his PR people. And he was meant to phone on a Saturday and he didn't phone. And I thought, oh, well, that's that. And then on a Sunday afternoon, I was sitting on the couch and I saw on my phone, there was a call from France and that was him. And he was such a nice guy and he was happy to talk and talk and talk. And I spoke to Russell Mulcahy, who was the first time I caught him. He was in Africa, I think. Mm-hmm. He was in a car in Africa. He'd been filming something. And then it took another year to actually get a proper interview with him. So I was chasing him for a while. And I spoke to Hugh Quarshie, who played Castagir on the bridge. Remember the boom boom scene where he takes out the drink? Yeah. So I spoke to him. And BT Edney, I spoke to briefly. And Roxanne Hart, of course, I spoke to her. Went down to Birmingham. She was at an event in Birmingham. And also people like the writers. So I spoke to the two guys who rewrote the original script, mm-hmm. Peter Bellwood and Larry Ferguson. I managed to track them both down and did a joint call with them. So we spoke for about an hour and a half about writing that script and their view on the world of Highlander. I don't know if you read any of the scripts before you watched the film, but the original script by Gregory Wyden is quite... quite different to the final script, and it's quite a lot darker. So these guys, Bellwood and Ferguson, really lightened the tone quite a bit and just made it a bit more fun and added humor to it. So it was really nice to speak to them about their approach. And also just I spoke to the chap who did the storyboards for the film, who had come over from Canada, was looking for a job and ended up working on the film. And he talked about meeting Sean Connery while he was doing his storyboards, and Sean Connery just being this old guy in a raincoat, and he didn't even recognize it was Sean Connery until he'd gone away. And yeah, so just lots of different people, stuntmen and people who were building sets, and the makeup lady who won an Oscar for Braveheart, I think, and okay. also the chap who did the costumes, Jim Aitchison, spoke to him. So, you know, quite a lot of different people, quite a lot of different views and different takes on the film, different people who are in different countries. I spoke to a chap who was the double, the stand-in for Christopher Lambert in Scotland. So I actually spoke to him for quite a long time about what it was like filming in the Highlands and his, you know, what it was like living in Fort William, which is this little town in the Highlands. He was living there during the filming, and people who were in this, who were doing in the battle sequences. Anyway, I could go on and on, but I spoke to lots of different sure. people.
Awesome. That's yeah. so cool. I mean, I know you want to save it for your book, of course, but is there one kind of fun fact or story that you would be willing to share at this point?
Well, there's lots of little facts. I think there's lots of things that I've uncovered that people will just not have heard before. Things down to, there's a scene where McLeod comes out of the loch, and because Ramirez has pushed him into the water, and mm-hmm. he drowns, but he doesn't drown. So I spoke to, when he comes out of the water, some fish fall out of his kilt, and I spoke to one of the people who got those fish. So he had to go off with his brother in a boat around the local kind of little ports and little sort of jetties and things around that area, trying to buy fish from people, and how the locals realized that they could make quite a bit of money off this film. So they weren't willing to sell them five fish. They had to buy like 100 fish. So,
oh my God.
So, I mean, little things like that, but right up to, I think that what's been really fascinating, and it doesn't sound very exciting, but it's been quite interesting, and I'm trying to make it sound interesting in the book. There's a risk that it won't, because it's about the business side of the film and how okay. it was made. It was funded. Stop me if it gets too boring, but basically it was funded by, it's a British film, which I didn't realize until I started started researching, because on the film, certainly in the UK, the Blu-ray that we have here has Canon films on it, has their logo.
Yeah.
But it was never made by Canon. Canon, the company that made the film, was called Thorn EMI, which was a huge British film company, filmmaker and distributor.
Okay.
But there's this whole story about how when Thorn gave all the money to the filmmakers, the company was basically falling apart behind the scenes. So as the filmmakers are off making this making Highlander around the world, you know, in Scotland and England and in America, the company's falling apart and they're trying to sell it. And so there's this whole story about how Canon Films came into it, and how I spoke to one of the marketing team who worked at worked at Thorn EMI. And mm-hmm. he talks about how he had all these great plans for the premiere of the film, and how they wanted to do something with Queen and maybe do a big tour with a kind of magic album and have Queen playing with sets from the film in the background and things like that. Yeah. And he talks about how just one day he came into work and was called into the canteen, and him and all his colleagues were told that Canon had bought the company and that everything was going to change. And that's kind of, so that's really why Highlander, I don't know if you talked about the fact that Highlander wasn't a huge success at the box office, but the reasons for that really come back to no marketing and the deal that was done behind the scenes in America as well with 20th Century Fox. So there's some stories about that, which I haven't read anywhere else, which I've found. Which again, as I say, it doesn't sound the most exciting thing talking about a film studio's finances, but I think it's quite interesting if you want to understand why Highlander didn't become this massive success. I think you've got to look a little bit more at the details of what was happening behind the scenes.
Sure, definitely.
So anyway, so that's something I've been quite interested in. And other things are just little stories, I suppose, about maybe what it was like. So when they were filming little things, there's lots of little stories. I mean, one of them is just which maybe doesn't sound very exciting, but about the makeup lady, Lois, mm-hmm. Lois Burwell is her name, talks about being in London when they were filming the scene between Castagir and the Kurgan when they're fighting in a New York street, but they were filming it in London. And she just talks about how her and her colleague were just sort of standing there beside the makeup, and someone came along, just a totally different. They'd already done some makeup on a double for the Kurgan, mm-hmm. and then suddenly this other guy turned up, and they just weren't expecting him. And there's a whole story about how this guy turned up, and they ended up drawing weird things on his head that you couldn't see in the film, and how the chap that was doing the a lot of the kind of wax, not wax works, but the sort of the bodies that get their head chopped off, just the fake bodies.
Yeah.
He sadly had, he sort of fell ill. I think he had a heart attack actually. And he was in the trailer with all these other bodies. So someone went in to try and get some makeup, and they were looking for this guy that was doing the bodies. And they realized that this poor guy had collapsed and fallen in with all these other headless bodies.
Oh my God.
In a trailer. And they realized they'd been stepping over him because he was just lying ill on the ground. So there's little things like that, which is, it's not funny, but it kind of, well, there's a dark humor to that, I suppose.
But, that's crazy. Wow.
But the whole stuff about filming in London and the effects going off, you know, explosions going off and the police coming and the fire brigade and all these different things. There's great little stories, which you have to speak to, of course, to all the people there that made it to get these stories, because they're just not, you can't easily find them on the internet or Wikipedia or anything like that.
Yeah. So I know you said you're not a huge fan of the rest of the films, but obviously this franchise has endured both in film and television. Why do you think that people care about it and that they continue to be able to produce these?
Yeah, I think, I suppose the central premise of the original film is just so good. Mm-hmm. It's so simple, really, isn't it? Just someone being able to live forever and what happens to them and what's their take on the world and things. So I think that the first film has, there's a lot of love towards that film. And I think a lot of people, I guess the theory was that, of course, if people like the first film, then they're going to watch the sequels. But I mean, I suppose the sequels, I don't know how successful they've been. I haven't looked at all the ins and outs of the money and the budgets and things. I think they always hope they're going to be more successful than they are, so they always manage to get money to make them. Mm-hmm. But I don't know how it's obviously not a kind of Star Wars size franchise or I don't know, even Fast and Furious these days franchise. It's not like it grows every time and gets bigger and more fans. I think it's a weird one. I think Highlander, it just sort of ticks over, and every few years they come out with a new thing and it does okay, but it's almost like more people just get annoyed with those films than enjoy them. It's a funny one. I think the TV series is different though. I think the TV series has quite a large fan base even now, and there's a lot of love for that when you go onto the Facebook pages and things. You know, there's still a lot of passion for those characters and for all those different stories they told. But the films, I don't know, I think it's just people, the producers trying to make more money, of course, like everyone is trying to do in film making. But every time they seem to lose a little bit more of what they had in the first place. So yeah, the idea of new Highlander films, no, I don't, I'm sure some people do, but I don't know who gets excited about the idea of another Highlander film if it's just going to be worse than the last one. Which is not a very positive thing to say, admittedly, but
well, what about the possibility of like remaking the first one?
Well, although I've just said people don't get that excited, I think the thing about the rumored reboot or remake is that the chap who directed the John Wick films is supposed to be directing them.
Chad
Stahelski, I think is how you pronounce it. Apologies if I've got that wrong, but I think that could be amazing if you can see what he does with guns. Imagine what he could do with swords and him and his team. So I think that core concept of Highlander is amazing, and I would love to see it done with love and care, and of course the first one, when they made it, they didn't plan for sequels, as you can tell at the end of the film when he, well, I won't spoil it for anyone who's not seen it, but I'm sure they wouldn't be listening to this if they
we spoiled it.
Yeah, so they didn't plan for it, but I think if you do it again, then of course you would plan for multiple sequels and spin-offs and things. Although personally I would love to see it as a Netflix series or an Amazon series, because I think it's got that, I think there's so much depth you could go into with different immortals and different backstories, that maybe TV is the way forward now.
Okay, great. So where can people follow you so that they can be sure to find out when the book comes out so they can grab it?
Yeah, well, Twitter is a good place. I'm at John, JON_Melville, MELVILLE. Or on Facebook, I think it's just / Jonathan Melville, JONATHAN. So those are the best places, really. And hopefully I'll have a bit more to say about the book in the next month or two. But I'm still just writing it and getting up in the mornings and writing it just now, so...
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us about it and give us a little preview. And we'll definitely, keep a lookout for when that's coming out.
Thank you. And I'm looking forward to hearing all your episodes. I'm going to have to listen to them, and then maybe I should watch the films again.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think we were a little bit hard on the first one, but we're excited to keep going and see how it goes. Because we don't have quite that nostalgia that maybe you and other people who watched it a little younger have.
Yeah, I know. I mean, a lot of people, yeah. I mean, I can't remember, when I spoke to Russell Mackay, I said something to him about, it's so good. What did I say to him? I made some comment to him, which was meant to be a compliment.
Something like it's so bad, it's good thing.
Something like that. And he just laughed, really. And he and I think everybody involved in it knows. They all tried their best.
Sure.
It was a tough shoot. They worked long, long, long days. Not many people who started, who were there at the start of the film, made it to the end of it. But it was made with, I think, a lot of... I mean, Russell Mulcahy, I'm not going to go into the detail because we're wrapping up, but Russell Mulcahy, of course, at the time... was huge in music videos. So his style, I think the style of it, hopefully we're kind of positive about the style and just the look of it. And it's kind of got that music video look to it, which then was very, well, maybe revolutionary, but certainly very different to a lot of films. And even now I think it stands out and I think it looks great. But there are moments, of course, that are cheesy and the effects are not amazing. And you can see wires and things, but anyway, I'll stop talking.
Yeah. Well, thank you again so much. I really appreciate it. And we will look out for the book.
Great. Thank you. Bye-bye.
So, yeah, we'll see you guys next week for Highlander 2.
This is the quickening!
Yeah! Yeah!
All right, see you guys.
Here we are, born to be kings. We're the